Hey guys, my name is Jason with Non-Banker Mining and Metals, and I've been getting asked a lot lately, is it worth smelting down your gold cons? So in today's video, we're gonna do a couple of smelts, we're gonna figure out how much gold I can recover, how much it cost me, and how much time was involved.
Here's what we're gonna be working with today, and this is a little bit of a special sample. This came out of Ghana. A friend from Ghana sent it up to me, and they were having some difficulty with the matte layer in this. So the matte layer is the sulfides that form during the smelt, and if you don't get your mix quite right, you'll have this layer between the metal on the bottom, a matte layer, and then the slag will be on top. So the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna weigh out a sample. I'm looking for about 100 grams. This stuff is wet, and so I'm gonna overshoot a little bit. We're gonna go to about 110 or 115 grams, and that'll give us about 100 grams of concentrates. So there's our initial concentrates. I have no idea what's in here. I don't know if it's pyrite, pyrrhotite, there's maybe some arsenopyrite in here, there may be some zinc sulfides. So it's really a total mystery on what's in this. So I'm gonna try and just use my general normal flux that I use. I'm gonna use some oxidizer, and I've got a special ingredient I haven't used before that I'm gonna try on this melt. I've been having real good luck lately mixing one part concentrates, one part anhydrous borax, 102, 103. So this is our anhydrous borax. Another part of soda ash, there we go. Then you add in somewhere between 20 and 40 grams of silica sand. It didn't look like that stuff had a whole lot of silica in it, so we're gonna shoot for about 30, somewhere in there. Now, because we have a sulfide-rich con, I'm gonna add in some potassium nitrate. And what this does in the smelt is it releases oxygen, which bonds to the sulfide molecules as well as the sulfur that's driven off during the smelting. And the idea is that it turns the sulfides into oxides, which are then absorbed into the slags. 50 grams might be a little strong, but we'll try it. So we'll add that in there. The problem is if you add too much, you can get some boil overs in your crucible, in your furnace, which you don't want. So I just got this stuff and I'm pretty excited about it. This is bismuth oxide. And in the past for my collector metal, I've used bismuth metal. But with the oxide, you get a couple advantages. The first is it has oxygen attached to it. And what the oxygen does is when it comes in contact with a sulfide molecule, it reduces the bismuth to metal and it oxidizes the sulfide. So you get iron oxide and that helps reduce the amount of sulfides you have in your ore, reducing the likelihood of getting a matte, as well as getting your collector metal really, really fine, really, really disseminated throughout the charge. And it really helps collect all that super fine, fine gold and silver we're trying to collect at the bottom. Now, I wasn't paying attention. I was shooting for 50 and I added 100. There we go. Now we got 49 grams of bismuth oxide. There's all our ingredients. Here's our 100 grams of concentrates. Here's our stuff all mixed up. It's a little bit orangey, orange in color. We'll put it in a brand new crucible here. There we go. Put our crucible in our furnace here. The smelt we just poured, it ended up boiling over. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna repeat it. I'm gonna have all the ingredients, including the concentrates. We're gonna try it again. I gotta keep all that stuff in the crucible because when it boils over, I might lose a little bit of collector metal and gold with it. But we're getting some interesting stuff here. So the first one that boiled over, I tipped it over out of the cone mold. I did not see any collector metal in the bottom. That tells me that the oxidizer has oxidized all the sulfides away and there's nothing left to reduce the bismuth oxide down to metallic form. So I just poured the 50 gram sample and I think the same thing happened. No collector metal, I haven't checked yet, but I didn't see anything pour out. What I'm gonna try now is I'm gonna do the same thing, same recipe. I'm gonna add some nails after it's all molten, all the oxidizer's been oxidized away. See if I can reduce any bismuth down to metallic form and have it collect in the bottom.
I'm gonna smelt the nails another 15 minutes after I put them in, and then we'll pour it into our cone mold, see if we get any reduced bismuth out of that. Want to try just the bismuth oxide, not any oxidizer, and see if we can use the bismuth oxide to oxidize the sulfides and induce the bismuth into metallic form, then we can flux the bottom.
Here is the exact same flux recipe with the oxidizer, with the bismuth oxide, and nails after it's all molten. But this is some concentrates from my new gold mine, and I know these are pretty much pure iron sulfides. You can already see the difference in the slag, but I wanted to do one for comparison. And so we can check the difference between this one and the other stuff from Ghana. Here's my sulfide slag, and here's the stuff from Ghana. So a lot more glassy. I think a lot of that stuff was oxides already instead of sulfides, whereas this stuff, it's kind of glassy still, but it's not as transparent. This stuff you can almost see through in the corners and stuff. This stuff is, it's almost waxy looking. I don't know how else to describe it. The thing I'm really happy about is there's the metal prill, and there's no matte layer at all. That flux recipe works really, really well for pure sulfides as well as, you know, more oxides if that's what we had from Ghana. So I'm really, really happy with that recipe and that mix for flux. It ends up being 89% bismuth by weight. So if we put in 25 grams of bismuth oxide, we should end up with 22.5 grams of bismuth. Now real quick, I wanted to go over these. This was the Ghana sample with the nails and the bismuth oxide. This was the Ghana sample with no nails, no oxidizer, and just the bismuth oxide. We got less than 1 gram, little button there. And that tells me there's hardly any sulfides in there, because if there was a bunch of sulfides, it would have reduced a bigger button of bismuth. This is just the bismuth metal. I didn't add any nails, and so we lost about 15 grams of the bismuth metal, probably from the oxidizer that I put in there, and then this is Jason's new gold mine concentrates. Now we're gonna get our precious metals out of these buttons, and to do that, we're gonna use a cupel. This thing I'm gonna heat up to about 1850 degrees Fahrenheit. I'm gonna place our bismuth prill in there, and it will melt the metal, it'll oxidize all the base metals, the bismuth, the copper, iron, any other base metals that are in there, and the cupel will absorb them like a sponge, leaving just the precious metal button in the cupel when it's all done. All right, we'll start with the nail sample. Got our cupel all warmed up. Our first button there. Now that'll start melting pretty fast, I believe. There it goes. Nice pure bismuth button. That's what we like to see. It kind of turns gray on the surface, and then it'll start to open up. There it goes. Those oxides are turning liquid, and they're becoming absorbed by the cupel. That's a very nice little showing. Then you have the dark raindrop looking things on the surface. That's the oxides forming in our hot, oxygen-rich environment. And that cupel will start to turn kind of that dark gray color. Well, now I want to explore a little bit about, is it worth smelting these concentrates? And so, you know, how much gold do you need to make it worth it? And so we're going to take 300 grams of Argonic concentrates, which I've weighed out at 330, again, 10% for water weight. I've got 300 grams anhydrous borax. I got 300 grams soda ash. I think I've got 100 grams of silica, and I've got 120 grams of potassium nitrate. I'm gonna add 150 grams of our bismuth oxide. Now we'll get it shook up real nice. Pour it in our large number 12 crucible here. And we should have enough room there for it to expand. We've got all our beads cupelled. They're all spread out here for everyone to see. I promise they're there. A couple interesting things. Here's the bead from the 14 gram button with the nail. And unfortunately, these are all so small, I can't weigh them on my thousandth of a gram scale. So we just gotta go kind of by the size. But I got 14 grams of collector metal. This one here is bigger than this one, but not by a whole bunch. And this was the one that had less than 1 gram. And so it's really interesting that the ratio of the size of the collector metal button doesn't necessarily mean the ratio of the amount of gold you recover. This one is the one I added the bismuth metal directly to, and I cannot see any gold bead in there at all with my naked eye. Once I'm editing the video, I might be able to find one when I zoom in, but I didn't recover anything with the bismuth metal, which was interesting because I've used that in the past and recovered gold, but maybe the bismuth metal isn't as efficient as the bismuth oxide is. And then I did an experiment. I've got my Jason's new gold mine concentrates, 22 gram button out of that one, and here's my bead right there as well, which it's hard to kind of qualitatively size them, but they're all roughly the same size, right? And I know that these should be about 150 grams per ton. So we're probably looking at somewhere in the 100 grams, 150 grams a ton range for all of our concentrates. Now, I did do a larger sample. I smelted down a 300 gram sample, but I got an 89 gram button. And then over here, I just poured this one. This is Jason's new gold mine concentrates number two as well. And I did a 500 gram sample of this. And so I'm gonna be really interested to see if we can scale up essentially 10 times the size of the bead, and hopefully we can get a weight on it. And then we can kind of answer our question, is it worth smelting 500 grams at a time? This is also interesting. I put a piece of flat bar in with my number two concentrates, and you can see how much of the steel got eaten up there. It took a lot of steel off of this flat bar. You can see how thick it was. I think it's 1/4 inch, and it just took it down kind of to a real thin little flat paddle there. Interesting that it ate it up around the top here too. Well, I beat on this thing for a while, and it does look like there might be a thin little coating of bismuth on there, especially down at the bottom there. And that would be where it was sitting in the puddle, right? At the very bottom of the crucible. Up here where it wasn't in the flux at all, there's really no, other than the discoloration of the steel, it doesn't look shiny or like a different metal, but right there on the surface of the bar where it was in the flux, it looks like there might be some bismuth attached there. And that might explain where some of our collector metal is going. If it's fusing itself to the nails or to the iron bar in there, we're gonna expect a little bit of loss. That also is gonna have a little bit of loss of precious metals, because you essentially make a bismuth alloy with precious metals. And as some of it gets bonded or welded to the steel, you're gonna lose some of those precious metals. Unfortunately, we're gonna have to wait on the results from my larger smelts. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna come back with part two, hopefully next week. We're gonna check out how much gold I recovered from my large beads and my 300 and 500 gram smelt. And then we're gonna do some smelts on some stuff that I know is worth smelting. So stay tuned for part two. Thanks everybody for watching, and we'll see you on the next video.